بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الواحد المنعم والصلاة والسلام على محمد سيد الأنام وعلى آله الكرام وصحبه العظام وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى ولا تكونوا كالذين تفرقوا وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المؤمن الذي يخالط الناس ويصبر على آذاهم خير من المؤمن الذي لا يخالط الناس ولا يصبر على آذاهم أو كما قال عليه الصلوات والتسليمات. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters and youngsters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by exalting and glorifying the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only Lord, the only entity entitled to worship, and we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. There is a very famous proverb in the Arabic language, and it goes something like this: Al-insanu aduun lima yajhal. Al-insanu aduun lima yajhal. That people fear what they are ignorant about. People fear what they are ignorant about. So if someone comes to me or yourselves and says, you know, let's get into this business, let's venture into this business, we have no idea about the business, about the markets in that specific commodity or that product or service. And when we are approached in this manner, we would be apprehensive to jump into this business because the facts are not before us. We need some time to ponder, we need some time to think. We need some information. We cannot be left in the dark. So when a person is ignorant about something, they are not educated about something, many times they fear. They fear that perspective or that specific commodity or that service or the issue at hand. Now the reality of the matter is that ignorance about Islam seems to be increasing. People have a misunderstanding about Muslims and Islam. I was speaking to a chaplain, Muslim chaplain, who works at one of the hospitals, and he was telling me that he was talking to a patient who was asking a lot of questions about Islam, a lot of questions about the Quran. So one day he approached the chaplain and he said, look, I'm interested in Islam, but I'm scared of one thing. So he said, what are you scared of? He said, if I accept Islam, I'll have to marry 4 wives. So little did he know that it's not a condition to be married to 4 wives in order to be a Muslim. But where has this come from? Where has this fear come from? Where has this perspective or this bias come from? It comes from ignorance. It comes from not knowing the reality. A revert sister was explaining her story. She accepted Islam, she started wearing the abaya, the long cloaks. And she went to school, she went to university with this abaya, with this long cloak. And there was embroidery on the garment. And they were circles. So someone passed a remark, what are those circles? Are they bombs? So again, where is this fear coming from? Where is this remark coming from? It's because the person who's making that statement has not understood Islam. That person who's making that remark does not know what Islam teaches. Hence, these type of remarks and these type of statements are being said. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, forecasted this situation for us. He said to the pioneers, he said to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ كَمَا بَدَى. He said, Islam started in a very strange manner. And there will be a time before the Day of Judgment where Islam will be looked upon as strange, as the odd thing. And ask yourselves that when we see our colleagues, they're drinking wine, and we as a Muslim say, no, that's not for me, I can't drink that. They're having pork, and we, as dictated by our belief, we say, I can't have that. Our friends may be gambling, but we say, hey, there's a teaching of Islam, and that motivates me to stay away from this activity. So people look at it as strange. Young people tell me that their non-Muslims friends tell them that, how can you survive without a girlfriend or a boyfriend? How can you be considered even a decent human being if you don't try wine and if you don't have all these other things that people enjoy? So it's the odd, it's strange. The Prophet ﷺ told us this. Islam started, it was looked upon as strange, as odd. And there will be a time, وَسَيَعُودُ كَمَا بَدَأ, that very same oddness or strange perspective about Islam, it will be the call of the day. And we sometimes question, is this the time that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was talking about? Nevertheless, the way to remove ignorance is education. The way to remove ignorance is education, awareness, and interaction. When we are equipped with knowledge, then we won't fear, because our knowledge will guide us. What do we say in Islam? We say, al-ilmu nurun. We say, knowledge is light. It guides us. Knowledge is light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him, can the people of knowledge be equal to those who don't have the knowledge? So knowledge is a guide. The story of Abu al-Walid is very famous. He was a judge in the vicinity of Mecca. He was very popular. He had a lot of wealth. He was an intellectual man. The Quraysh, they were fed up of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, speaking about Islam, speaking about Tawheed, the oneness of God. They were in a sense of confusion as well. They didn't know whether what the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was preaching, whether it was the truth or not. So they approached this man of intellect, Abu al-Walid. According to some reports, his name was Walid. They approached this man. They said, you're a man of intellect. You're a man of wealth. You're a man of position. You're a man who makes judgments for us. We want you to make a judgment. Is what the Prophet, peace and blessings, what Muhammad is talking about, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is it truth? Is there any reality to it? So he said, give me some time. I cannot make a judgment until I actually hear and see what he's talking about. So he comes in the presence of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. And he asks the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. I'm trying to summarize a very lengthy narration in Sahih Bukhari. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is asked by Abu al-Walid that, share your poetry with me. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, responds and he says, this is not poetry. In huwa illa wahyun yuha. It's revelation that is being revealed from God. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, after he had heard his side of the story or his side of the discussion, he asked him, have you completed what you want to say and your objections? He said, yes. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, let me now recite what God has revealed to me. And he started reciting, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim Hamim Tanzilum Minar Rahmanir Rahim. These are the verses of Surah Fussilat. According to some reports, 6 verses of the Quran were recited before this man. And the man was taken aback. He was mesmerized. And it's mentioned in some of the reports, for a certain period of time after returning home, he didn't leave the home. The people came, the Quraysh came to him. We sent you for a mission and you haven't responded. So when he did come out, he told the people that what he has recited, it cannot be the word of poetry. It cannot be the word of a human. It has to be from a supreme being. And I advise you to leave him to his message and his propagation and his invitation to the deen. So the point of mentioning this particular story or this tale from the seerah and the biography of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was approached from an ignorant perspective. The Quraysh were sort of like the enemy. They did not like the message of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. But the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him's message was not understood by these people. But when the person of intellect understood the message, the ignorance, as we say, the fog was removed. He was now equipped, he was now educated in what he heard directly from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not through a third party. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, removed the ignorance, and through that, this man was able to understand what this message was about. It was about justice, it was about peace, it was about the greatness of the Creator, and that there's no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what we learn from this is, we need to remove the ignorance that is out there about Islam, firstly by equipping ourselves with education. We need to know our own deen. We need to know our own religion. And if we know it and we practice it, then we can share it to others. Then we can talk about it. Then we can dialogue. Then we can communicate with others. And we can go to the next step of interaction. So it begins with us. We have to educate ourselves. And whatever little we know, we can share. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they've always encouraged that we educate ourselves. In fact, a great scholar of Islam was speaking about ignorance and knowledge. And he explained by saying that Islam is a religion that is based on knowledge. Islam is a religion that is based on knowledge. The more we equip ourselves with knowledge, the more confident we will be about Islam. But the less knowledge we have about Islam, the less knowledge, the less education we have about our religion, the more weaker we will become in terms of our position regarding the religion of Islam. So it's an information-based, it's a knowledge-based religion. The more we learn, the more we practice, the more confident we'll become. And this is in any matter, when we look at any issue, if we're not educated, if we don't have the skills and the talents, we're not confident in addressing that matter. So this is why it's important that we help remove this ignorance by becoming educated ourselves. There was a research that was done recently by the Pew Research Foundation, and it was mentioned just to show, just to give an idea of how ignorant people are about Islam. 50% of North Americans don't even know that the religious book for Muslims is called the Quran. 50% of North Americans, they don't know that our religious book is called the Holy Quran, the Noble Quran. When we ask any average Muslim that what's the book of the Christians, they'll tell us it's the Bible, it's the Gospel. But the average North American is so uneducated, it's so ignorant about Islam, that they don't even know that this is the name of our holy book, this is the name of our religious book, let alone other matters. So when this is the situation, we got to do a lot of work. There's a lot of work on our plates, and we need to be part of this education and awareness. I recently asked a question on my Facebook, and the question was that, what do you term a Canadian Muslim? I'm asking the Muslims, what do you call a Canadian Muslim? So all kinds of responses. One of the common responses is, you're a Canadian and you're a Muslim as well. There's no rocket science to that. But people don't believe that. People out there don't understand that. There's ignorance out there. So one young man wrote that if you make iftar with Timbits, then you're a Canadian Muslim. So we need to definitely be part of the system. When we interact, then people will see us. And this is my second point here. We want to remove the ignorance. We want to remove the ignorance. Then what we got to do is we need to educate ourselves. Number two is we need to interact. We cannot remain in isolation. We cannot remain in isolation. No longer. We have to be part of the system. We have to be part of the community. We've got to be part of the society on all levels. And when we do this, then we will see that the ignorance will be eliminated. The ignorance will be eliminated slowly, slowly. We'll win one heart at a time, one person at a time. I came across a narration in Musnad Ahmad. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was in a journey. He was traveling. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was with the Prophet. He said there was a man who was with us, a Sahabi who was with us, and as we were traveling, we passed by a beautiful oasis. And there was like, there was Uyayna, there was a spring of water, a small spring of water, Ma'an Azb. And the water was so sweet, and there was some greenery within the oasis. And the man, you know, he looked at it and he said, and Abu Huraira overheard him. The man said, I wish I can just stop, i'tazaltu, and just leave every human being, leave every person, and get into that oasis and spend the rest of my life there. So then, being a Sahabi, being a companion, you know, they had access to the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Anytime they had confusion, anytime they had ignorance, they didn't need to search Mufti Google. They went straight to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They went straight, directly to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this man, he makes this wish that I wish I could abandon everyone and everything and get into this oasis and spend the rest of my life, a never-ending vacation. So he goes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, I cannot make any move unless I ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He approaches the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. فَذَكَرَ ذَلِكَ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقَالَ The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, tells him, لَا تَفْعَلْ He says, my instruction is, don't do that. He said, you need to be amongst the people. You can't be isolated. You gotta be amongst the people. You gotta be within the community. You gotta be within the society. And then he made a wonderful remark. He said, when you do something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the society, within the community, then خَيْرٌ مِّن صَلَاتِ سِتِّينَ عَامًا خَالِيًا It's better than being in isolation and performing prayers, endless salah for 60 years in that seclusion. It's better to be amongst the community, be part of the concerns of the community. You know, when we're isolated, who are we going to be generous to? When we're isolated, who are we going to be patient with? When we're alone, who are we going to be tolerant with? If we're alone in our own homes, and we're not part of the community, we're not part of the concerns of the society, we're not part of the mainstream society and the concerns of the society, where are we going to follow all of these instructions that the Prophet ﷺ talks about? Tolerance, patience, interaction, kindness, compassion. Where can we practice that if we're in isolation? So the purpose and the objective of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was that we be amongst the people and become those who are God-fearing. Because it's very easy to go into isolation and become God-fearing. But to be amongst the people, and this is one of my teachers, he would always say, he said, right now you're in the seminary. Right now you're amongst the people who are only talking about Allah and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. The real challenge is not here. It's when you leave. It's when you're in the real world and you're challenged. Your faith is challenged. Your values are challenged. Your position is challenged. That's the real test. So, how do we remove ignorance? One of the methodologies is, according to this report that we find in Musnad Ahmad, is that we have to be amongst the people. And when we're amongst the people, people will see our contributions. People will see what we stand for. People will see that we're like any other human being. Right? I attend numerous interfaith groups, etc. And I notice this. This seems to be a trend. For example, if I'm invited in a church, and I always mention that usually I dress like this, with my turban and my cloak, etc. So when it's my turn to speak, I just notice that the audience is now tensed. All of a sudden, they feel tensed. So I get onto the podium, and I'm sure they're thinking, what is this guy going to talk about? So what I do is I first break the ice. You see, when a person has a perception, they make their perception by one of two things. They make their perception by image. So the first thing that they have seen is an image of me. And there's a connotation. They're being bombarded with media pictures on the news, etc., about terrorists who dress in a certain way, and the link is made. So them being tense, I don't blame them. It's natural. So perceptions are firstly made by image. And another way a perception is made is through communication, by hearing. but either seeing or hearing. So when I get onto the podium and I begin talking and I break the ice, so I would, if it was a day like today, I would probably say, you know what, our mayor is in some hot water. The Leafs have lost. Inshallah, you know, in the future we'll see, something might happen. So you start communicating, you start dialoguing, and that tense situation all of a sudden is gone. And now you talk about Islam. You talk about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they say, you know what, this is the very same teaching that is in the Bible. And I say, that's why we believe in the Bible. We don't deny it. The authentic revelation that has come from God in the form of the Injil, in the form of the Bible, we believe in it. So interaction removes ignorance. People become closer to us, and then we can get our message across to them. Let me give you an example from the prophetic life. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, did this very skillfully. It's a very lengthy narration. I have a few minutes. I'm just going to wrap up, inshallah, with this specific narration. There was an individual when the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was migrating from Mecca to Medina. It was a hidden journey of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. And the Prophet was encountered by 80 assassins. 80 people came to the Prophet and they all came to him to assassinate the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Their leader was Buraydah al-Aslami. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was approached and confronted. And this man has come with his spear. He's about to kill the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. The Prophet says, hold on, calm down. Take it easy. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, let's talk. Let's have some communication here. He said, Ana Muhammad. He said, my name is Muhammad. Man anta? He said, what's your name? He said, Buraydah. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, looked at Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and he said, Ya Aba Bakr, baruda amruna wa saluha. He said, this guy's name is Buraydah. Buraydah comes from calm and being cool. He said, Abu Bakr, there's nothing to worry at all from these 80 people because their leader is calm and cool. So he laughed. Buraydah laughed. Then the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, asked him, Mimman, from which clan do you belong to? From which tribe do you belong to? So he said, Al-Aslam. I come from the Aslam tribe. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, looked at Abu Bakr. Islam, Aslam, Salima means peace. He said, our matter is peaceful now, because their leader is peaceful. And then the Prophet ﷺ asked him one more question. He said, from your clan and tribe, which forefather do you come from? So he said, Sahm. I come from Sahm. Sahm in Arabic means a portion or a share. So the Prophet ﷺ looks at Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and he says, now definitely there's nothing to fear because we just got our share of people. Then the Prophet ﷺ, after breaking the ice, he talked to him. He said, you think I'm a bad person? And the Prophet ﷺ said, I'll tell you why people are causing a problem in Makkah for me. And he said, the only reason is I'm calling towards one Allah. I'm calling towards one God. And they're worshipping idols and I disagree with that. That's the only reason why they've caused this situation that my people have migrated and I'm migrating now. So he said, if that is the matter, let me understand your message. He explained the message. Buraydah accepted Islam and the 80 individuals that were with him who came for what? To assassinate the Prophet ﷺ. And every one of these 80 people, they entered Medina with the Prophet ﷺ as Muslims. And how did that how was that ignorance removed? It was through the interaction of the Prophet ﷺ. It was through the dialogue and the communication that the Prophet ﷺ built. And through that, it changed the situation. So we have a lot of ignorance that is around us, but we shouldn't lose hope. By educating ourselves, creating awareness, and by being part of the community. I was fortunate yesterday to be in a meeting where Dr. Muhammad Lashmi has just been appointed. Algerian Muslim brother from our community has been appointed as the vice president of Ryerson University. And he was being acknowledged, and we were there at the event. So this is an example when people will see that we are part of the community. We are part of the society. And as Muslims, we are equally contributing. And he's not hiding his name. He's not calling himself Mo Lashmi. He's saying Muhammad Lashmi. He's taking the name of Islam. He's taking the name of Muhammad with him. This is what we need to do. We can't become ignorant with the ignorant. We got to educate ourselves and we got to interact with our Islam, with the people. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with the ability to educate ourselves. May Allah allow us to be amongst those who create awareness of the genuine Islam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who interact in a peaceful manner that brings people closer to Islam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the success of this life as well as the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.